Sure, thanks.
So yes, definitely this should be available. We'll post it, the link to you.
Sure, thanks.
All right, so I think it's a good interaction. So quickly, I'll kick off the session. I think we have very good attendance. In case you have any question, please raise your hand. Otherwise, we'll have this FAQ by end of the session. So let's understand, these are the agenda I'm going to cover in next 60 minutes. I was supposed to have this for 2 hours, but due to some, one of the speaker has got some personal emergency. So we will have this 1 hour only, but we can host another session sometime later. So let's quickly, let's understand what is happening, a bit of, you know, impact, because everywhere people are talking about automation. So I'd like to just go back and ask from this community, from the forum, really, do you know now the industry is talking about fourth industrial revolution? So what does this mean by fourth industrial revolution, and how do you see the impact on the entire our society and the community? Any idea?
Yeah, I think artificial intelligence is already making its impact.
Yeah, definitely. So it's a right answer. Of course, fourth industrial revolution is the artificial intelligence. But if you see the larger horizon, it's a connected world. So it's not only artificial intelligence. Artificial intelligence is impacting a lot. But if you see the larger, higher horizon, it's artificial intelligence, IoT, blockchain, virtual reality, 3D printing and cyber security, it's all are coming together into the business. And really, this is blurring the digital as well as the physical boundary of our life. And this world is going more and more towards digital. And definitely, artificial intelligence and primarily on automation, it's playing a very, very vital role and automating a lot of jobs. But now the fundamental question comes here, why the fourth industrial revolution is different than the second, third or first industrial revolution? Why the people are talking about fourth industrial revolution and why it's going to eliminate a lot of jobs? What is the difference? So the answer is very simple, because all the industrial revolution has not actually impacted the human. Still human was relevant, but in the fourth industrial revolution, it's impacting the human. It's start acting just like a human. For example, now due to fourth industrial revolution, now the computers has got two hands to work on keyboard and mouse. It has got two eyes to see. It has got one mouth to speak. It has got ear to hear. It has got brain to think like a human. So primarily, still the technology has not become so matured, but artificial intelligence as a technology, it's mimicking the human hand and the human brain, and definitely this is going to impact a lot of opportunity in the future. So this data, I mean, a lot of Gartner and other data that talks about a lot of job will be cut down, a lot of at least repetitive down the line, the jobs which are at the bottom of the entire value chain, definitely this will impact, and especially India and China would be the most impacted geography into the entire world. So this is just a data. The objective is not to discourage, objective is not to scare, but fundamental reason I'm just bringing, how can we upskill and reskill ourselves? So just, I'm just putting a quick poll to everybody. Considering the artificial intelligence impact, or you know, how many of you think that definitely emergent technology will change your job profiles in next 2 to 5 years? I do not have the poll, but if you can post it on the chat window, definitely this will help us to understand. How many of you think that emergent technology, RPA, AI and IoT will change your job profiles in next 2 to 5 years? Can you please poll it, put it on the chat window? I'm just monitoring. I can see most of the people are saying, yes, it will change. Okay, it's already in. Yes, absolutely right. Fair enough. All right, so most of the answer I got it, yes, definitely it will change. So one side of the coin, what I have showed you that talks about a lot of job elimination that will happen due to the impact and the, you know, the onset of artificial intelligence. But this data, I mean, that was the, you know, kind of disappointing data. But if you see this data, what Gartner is talking about, If you see the blue line, it's a loss of the jobs due to impact of automation. If you see this light blue bar, this is the gain. So if I talk about where we stand at of, as of today, 2018, this blue is more loss of the job, close to, you know, close to 0.8 million jobs will be eliminated, but at the same time, it will create 0.6 million jobs. But eventually, when we are going to 2020, you see the more opportunities are on the way. You see here, more opportunities are on the way, but less opportunity, less jobs, it's eliminating. But if I see, if I show you the horizon on 2025, lot of opportunities on the way. Lot of opportunities on the way, but it's eliminating very less jobs. So what this data talks about? The message is pretty clear that essentially it's eliminating the jobs, but at the same time, it's creating a different set of opportunity, different set of, you know, the opportunity altogether that we have to get ready to grab all those opportunity. This is the Gartner data published in 2018. You see here in 2025, 2024, a lot of opportunity coming on the way. So gain is more as compared to loss. So net, net, we are in profit. We are in gain, not in loss. So question, the answer is very, the message is pretty clear here that we, everybody have to get ready for tomorrow, for 2025. We have to get ready. We have to upgrade our skill set. We have to upskill and reskill ourselves to grab all the opportunity that is coming on the way. So just to touch upon what are the different opportunities available in the industry. All right, so guys, I'm just touching upon what are the different upskilling and reskilling opportunity available in the industry where we can make ourselves ready. And RPA, AI and ML is that are the three essential core parts that is the attraction, center of attraction for today. We'll be touching upon RPA and how RPA and AI is coming together. But definitely RPA, ML and AI is playing a very vital role in the entire ecosystem. And if I give you some data, close to $192 billion would be the market value by 2025. This is the prediction, the market prediction. The other area that is transforming the entire manufacturing industry is the IoT, Internet of Things. I'm not sure how many of you know, but nowadays the software world as well as the manufacturing industry or the hardware world is coming together. And on top of that, artificial intelligence playing a very vital role into finding the predictive, doing the predictive analysis and finding a lot of things. So IoT at the same time, this is doing a lot of stuff into making our house and our, you know, warehouse, making it more smart. So almost all the vehicles or houses are becoming smart due to IoT. Blockchain is another area that is fantastic opportunity that is coming on the way. This is pretty matured, prematured, and it's an onset of blockchain into the industry. So earlier when the blockchain started, people just talk about cryptocurrency, but essentially that's not true. Blockchain has got huge cases into each and every industry, and it's very, very promising. It's coming on the way. So if you are trying to make your career after artificial intelligence, blockchain could be a very promising field where we can think across. It's coming in a big way, and definitely it will open a lot of floodgates for us. The another area is the virtual reality. Industry is working big time, especially into e-commerce and e-commerce as well as the retailers. They are working big time to enhance the virtual reality. In fact, a lot of hospitals are working on virtual reality. How can we improve the customer experience using the technology? Cybersecurity, of course, it's already there, and it's since last 10 years, a lot of opportunity on the way. One of the item is missing here. I forgot to put it. That is called 3D or 5D printing. So there are reports. China has manufactured, printed actually one small bridge using a 3D printer and the 5D printer. In fact, now 5D printer has the ability to print the entire house. Now, a lot of companies are evaluating how to print the watch as well as the clothes using 3D and 5D printing. So a lot of things are coming with 3D and 5D printing. So essentially, just I'm touching upon what could be your upskill and reskill opportunity available in the market. Okay, so I'll just skip this polling. I'll move ahead. So next item is RPA. I'll not touch upon much on the RPA, but I'll just for the sake of the audiences, because a lot of people here, I think they are new to RPA, just I'll touch upon and then I'll move on the cognitive RPA side. Hope this would be okay with everybody.
Yeah, sure.
All right. So let's little understand before we get it into RPA, let's understand the manufacturing world. What is happening here? If you see, this is a typical assembly line that is capable to produce the cars. And in order to produce the cars, the humans are doing a lot of, the human activity that is required in order to support the assembly line. This was happening some a decade or two decades ago into almost all the manufacturing, all the assembly lines. Even though we have the assembly line, but the humans are, doing nut bolting and doing a lot of activity to produce the car. Let's understand the situation, what is happening today. In today's world, as of today, at present, the robots are taking over the plants. Almost all the humans are being replaced by the robots. And it has the obvious reason, because when the robot walks on the assembly line, it makes the plants more competitive. It helps the plant to produce more, manufacturing. It helps the plant to more, produce more outcome. At the same time, this reduces a lot of human intervention, because whenever there is a human intervention, this makes the processes slow. So there is a data that suggests the US manufacturing and the China manufacturing, the fate or the future lies into the robots. So again, going back to the previous slides, I am showing you 2 decades ago, this is entirely being handled by the humans. Now at present, most of the activities are being handled by the bots, the robots. And these robots are something that we can feel, we can touch, and we can see, because these are called manufacturing bots. And now why the industries are being deploying the bots? Because they wanted to make the plant more competitive compared to their competitors. At the same time, they want to increase the output, of course, quality, reducing the cost. Those all are the other primary the regions. So let's understand, let's try to replicate the same concept into our software world. What is happening here? So before we get it into, let's understand what is automation. I'll not spend much of the time, but the fundamental definition of automation, the delegation of work from human to machine to reduce the cost, improve the efficiency, and enhance the customer experience in automation. You go across anywhere, what essentially we are doing into automation, whether it's a .NET automation, Java automation, or whatever earlier our civilization, this is what the primary, the definition of automation. If I go to the process, a series of steps taken in order to achieve outcome is called processes. And when I club together, it's nothing but a series of steps that is being performed by the machines in order to improve the efficiency and reduce the cost. It's called process automation. This is the by definition, by dictionary, the definition of process automation. Now I'm helping you to understand why industry all of a sudden start prefixing robotic or the robot board before process automation, and why this is happening. So quickly, let's understand what are the different process automation as of today available into the industry. SAP. So SAP is primarily, it has transformed all the business operation into the industry. If you talk about HR, you talk about finance, you talk about material management, or you talk about any enterprise landscape, SAP has done 80% of the transformation into the industry. And I don't think so any of the processes are there into industry that is not been automated using SAP. CRM, primarily into customer relationship management, either Siebel or Salesforce. Mainframe, almost all the banking, finance, and healthcare industries are being captured and being caught by the mainframe. Custom solutions, either .NET, Java, or any based solution that is being integrated. Or data warehousing, whether it's a BI or the reporting, or a lot of other tools. I mean, ServiceNow or Remedy, you talk about. These are the process automation, that is available. But now the fundamental question comes. There are 3 questions I'd like to ask from the forum here. Question number 1, though all the processes are being automated, I don't think so any process that is not being automated by all the systems, though all the processes are being automated, billions or billions of dollars have been invested into automating the processes. And the third thing that all the processes are being automated, and all of a sudden, why do we need to have the robotic process automation? Why the robotic word has been prefixed before process automation? We need to understand. Anybody has any thought, any idea? Feel free to let me know, just to make it interactive.
I think because in spite of all the processes being automated, there is still needed an human intervention.
Okay. Yes, it's a valid answer. Anybody else?
To my knowledge, this is Pankaj. So to my knowledge is analytics is something, you know, which is done by the humans. And because robotics, from the process to the automation, we understand it's a series of steps they could follow. But if there is a change or a deviation in a process or in a VSM model, then the robotics or the programming has to go under change. And for that, the humans' interventions are required. And also, still, we are not at par with the cost-benefit analysis, robotics and the human combination. So I think these are not 100% foolproof, but there is some work to do on those aspects.
Okay, fair enough. So what we are trying to say here, though we have the system in place, but still this required a lot of human intervention to support the business function, right? To support our processes. So look at this data. What this data is talking about, though our processes are being automated into our entire enterprise landscape, but ERP plus other systems, it could be your CRM, it could be your .NET based automation, it could be your reporting or etc. To the overall contribution is only 20% of the overall automation. ERP and other systems only contribute only 20% of the overall automation, but rest 80% is being supported by the human in order to support the business function or in order to support the processes. How many of you agree with me? The data may be fluctuate plus minus 10%, but essentially this is one of the report given by Automation Anywhere. All right. So this is the data. It's saying that even though we have the system in place, though everything is being automated, but 80% of the time this required human intervention in order to support our processes. And wherever you will see the human touch and human intervention, definitely the cost will go very high. At the same time, your cycle time would be always high. When customer is demanding the things instantly, I think human touch is always kind of killer for any enterprise. So again, I'm going back to my previous slide. So what are those gaps into the process automation? Again, I'm going back to my previous slide where I showed you this assembly line. You look here, the assembly line in our process automation world, in software world, is nothing but our existing systems. For example, it could be SAP. It could be CRM, it could be mainframe, it could be our custom-based solution, either Java, .NET, or it could be reporting, or it could be ServiceNow, it could be Remedy. This is our assembly lines I would map with the manufacturing world. And what humans are doing here, they are supporting the entire assembly line, they are supporting the SAP systems, because when the SAP systems or the legacy systems are being built up on that time, it itself has created a lot of gaps, and those humans are supporting. And now coming back to this slide, essentially what is happening, now we are building the software bots that will essentially mimic or replicates the human interaction sitting on the existing system, sitting on the assembly line of SAP or any CRM or the Oracle or your mainframe or ServiceNow. So message is pretty clear. Though we have the system in place, SAP or any systems, but we are building to eliminate or reduce the human intervention on the existing system, to make our processes very efficient, to reduce the cost in order to improve the operational efficiency and improve the customer experience. You see here, what are the gaps available in as of today current systems? It's a paper-based transaction. You go across any processes. Papers are pretty much available into any processes, whether you go to AP, you go to AR, you go to customer employee onboarding, customer employee onboarding, supplier onboarding. Broken IT system is something, because the processes are being built up in the last 1 to 2 years, and almost the systems are legacy, and it's not doesn't explain the data structure due to many regions. Systems are legacy, it's complex, and it threw a lot of business exceptions. So I think business exception is something that the business rules are not matched, and that's the reason this is being all supported by the human the executives. Last but not the least, the unstructured information. One of the study that say that in an enterprise, 85% of the data is unstructured data. So whenever it comes to unstructured data, this required a human intervention. So unstructured data could be anything. I mean, your structured data is only spreadsheet and database that is the tabular format, where you have the prefix defined, rows and columns. But whenever anything comes like image or invoice or any unstructured, any body, male body or anything, that is all unstructured. So essentially what happened, that leads to a lot of data entry, hopping across the multiple systems, verification, validation, and comparison of data. Verification and validation, why happens? Because human create a lot of data entry. This required to be validated. This required a lot of decision making. So either human will make the decisions or computer, or the computer will make the decisions. And last but not the least, in any process, there are a lot of email reading and writing happens. So what happens when we scale our business operations? If we have a lot of business processes, we have the shared services, and if you are scaling with 3x, 4x or 10x down the line, 5 to 10 years, what essentially should be the different options where we can explore? The one option could be we can start deploying our human workforce. That is essentially what happened exactly into the back office operation or shared services. So if you start scaling your human workforce, definitely the cost will go very high. So cost is not in terms of the human salary, the people's salary, but it has got a lot of other costs. It could be infrastructure, it could be your the IT infrastructure, it could be their other expenses, the training, retraining, and etc. It creates a lot of quality issue. At the same time, when human do the activity, that has comes with the quality issue and the rework, and definitely it hits a customer experience. So I would like to just share one data. It's saying that by 2025, customer experience will precede the cost. So the cost management will become the traditional project management activity, but essentially all the company would be deploying RPA and artificial intelligence or analytics to improve the customer experience. Compliance issue, definitely if you're into regulatory and compliance, a single small mistake, a quality issue will cause a lot of the money. And training and retraining would be, of course, the region. So what are the fresh look? How can we solve the problem using the technology? So as of now, that's where the lot of industry and the company started adopting to solve their problem using the technology, because now technology has become cheap and it's offering a lot of stuff. That's the reason the companies are rushing and adopting and trying to leverage the power of the software and artificial intelligence. And ladies and gentlemen, one of the technologies is robotic process automation. So essentially what happens, RPA as a technology that helps you to build the digital workforce. Once again, I am repeating, RPA as a technology helps you to build the digital workforce. So digital workforce is essentially nothing, but it's just the replica of human, what humans are doing. We'll talk about the rule based, but essentially what humans are doing, it will start essentially doing. So what you can do, essentially what humans are doing, those are repetitive. Repetitive essentially means that what humans are doing day in, day out, all the time, that is a time consuming repetitive process and high transactional data. We can build the digital workforce and we can deploy into our operation server room. So what humans are doing, essentially this digital workforce will start doing, and it will start doing, and this will definitely, it will be up and running 24/7, 365, and definitely it will make our processes more fast, more efficient, with the very lower cost. And of course, once it will be trained, even the employee leave or go out of the organization, there won't be any impact. Any questions so far here on RPA world? All right, so quickly, please.
Can you show us an example of a typical process automation that is done with an RPA, so the concept will be
clear. So I'll just show you quickly one video. Just give me 1 minute. Hope you are able to view my screen. So look here, this is the SAP order creation system. Sorry, it's in Chinese, but I just picked up some video. So now this is not being handled or data is not being created by any bot. This is being created by the robots. It's capable enough to navigate across any screen, select the different rows, create the data. And the way human click any button, the way human pull any data, essentially it's capable enough to do whatever the stuff humans are doing. It's capable enough to identify the rows, identify the elements, identify the buttons, navigate and save the data and come out of the data. So this is order creation system.
And what we are saying is the advantage over here is that this can be configured by any layman. You don't need any specific programming background or knowledge of any particular technology.
Well, so to answer your question, of course, this is a different kind of a skill set. You may, essentially need to learn because each and every tool has its own way of working. But in case you can spend some 3 months to 6 months of time, essentially you can automate simple processes. And I don't think so you need to have any programming background. So is it clear something? Or did you get the message?
Yeah, that makes sense. Thank you so much.
Fair enough. All right. So I'll just... Any question?
Yes. Have you seen any difference between chatbot and this RPA bots?
Yeah. So I'll cover in this session, the part two session where I would be talking about chatbot and RPA bot. And in fact, I would be addressing how RPA bot and chatbot can work together into entire landscape. Is it okay if you can hold this question for another 10
minutes? Sure. Thank you.
All right. Hello. Yes, what is the question?
No, would you be covering a couple of more use cases around RPA?
Quickly, I'll walk through in the conscious of time. Yes, I'll try to cover 2-3 use cases. So I'm just moving ahead. Guys, please go and mute in case you are not speaking. So RPA has got almost all the capability what humans are doing. For example, web-based navigation, saving the data, Windows-based applications, Excel-based, Excel manipulation and Excel saving of the data. The emails automation, whatever the emails are coming to and fro, that can be automated by downloading the attachment, scrapping the data from the documents, copying and pasting, logging into an enterprise application, read and write data to database at the same time. Integrating with the different web services, it's pretty much capable enough to do it. Limitation, we'll talk about, there are a lot of limitation with the RPA, but essentially you can leverage the power of web-based, window-based, Citrix-based automation, emails essentially, and your database. And just quickly skipping a couple of slides because this will become too much of heaviness. But essentially, if you see here, one of the primary characteristic of RPA, that it's no coding automation, but this is one of the kind of myth that's not true. 20% of the time, 30% of the time you need to code because RPA comes with all the ready-made activity, but sometimes the activities are not being supported. It's not available in that time. You may need to code your RPA bots. Then the business people will have the fundamental question, then how, without having the coding knowledge, how can I code it? The answer is very simple. Here you can collaborate with your IT team. Here you can collaborate with RPA developers. But essentially, in case you want to know, you want to code, you want to automate, I think there is no brainer. You can do it here. I know a lot of companies where the people from finance and the people from HR, they are automating their processes without having any programming background. And one of the company last week, I was there in Bangalore, the very huge case from Adani Group. Adani Group has not hired any RPA developer, and all their operations people are automating their processes by their own with the hand holding of the experts, RPA experts. So this is just motivational things. I am motivating everybody in the operation and the business to start attempting automating their processes, start learning and really see what is happening. Unless you will not wait into the business, definitely you will keep, you know, observing and watching, nothing will happen. So essentially, use case would be data entry is the soft spot. Whenever you find any data entry, what is wherever happening across any industry, whether it's HR, finance, head services, supply chain management, or account payable, account receivable, finance, anywhere, wherever you go, data entry, the first sweet spot to catch the data entry stuff and automate with RPA. This will free a lot of your bandwidth, and 60% of your bandwidth can be freed from this activity. Straight through processing is something, if you talk about any process, if you talk about a very simple process, for example, employee onboarding process cut across the multiple systems. It could be employee management system, it could be payroll, it could be IT, it could be PF, it could be tax. And what happened, those systems are not supporting each other due to many reasons. In that case, human supports creating entry into the multiple systems. So whenever you come across any straight through processing, definitely that is a very good choice to automate using RPA bots. I'll just skip this part, but nowadays RPA is being used as a virtual integration. So people are evaluating, in fact, without having the web service integration among two systems, why not RPA bots can be, you know, used as a virtual integration without changing anything in the underlying systems. We can use RPA bots to integrate and, you know, exchange the data among the different systems. This is reporting. Wherever you see the opportunity, the reporting essentially means that every day morning, if you have to pull the data from multiple sources, it could be your the SAP reports, and then you have to pull the data from CRM, consolidate, and then clean the data, put it some narration. At least 60 or 70% of the stuff can be automated using RPA bots. So reporting, wherever you see what humans are supporting, essentially, definitely it's a very good use case. I won't be touching upon, multiple use cases and where can be done, but I would be just touching about the industry where RPA can be a good fit. And of course, banking and insurance is the area where that is primarily in a lot of, industry, a lot of BFSI sector, this is being adopted. I'm so sorry, I do not have anything into banking, but in banking, it could be KYC, it could be, trade finance, it could be trade clearance, everything can be done. But in insurance, I would say claim processing, underwriting processing, policy administration, client profile on board, client onboarding. These are the very prominent use cases that can be used into the insurance, and especially into claim processing and underwriting processing, a lot of, back office operation, the humans are supporting all this activity. So banking and finance after healthcare prominently adopting. If you go to healthcare, especially, the revenue cycle management, RCM, is the area where a lot of hospitals started adopting. Whenever it comes to insurance eligibility, at the same time ensuring the payments are coming on time, at the same time ensuring, the revenue is not leaked. So in RCM space, a lot of, the use cases has emerged and companies have adopted to, solve a lot of issue. Human resource, especially the recruitment. CV argument, your resume argument is primary. It's a very good use case, I would say, in recruitment and human resources, very much the impacted areas, especially employee onboarding, recruitment, payroll processing, compliance reporting, as well as, the IT support and etc. is very good use cases into human resource. If I go to finance services, especially into shared services, account payable, account receivable, reconciliation, business exception processing, credit card processing, payment, dispute resolution, these are the very huge cases. General ledger, Those are the very good use cases. This is not limited to this category, but there could be many more. Supply chain has got a lot of use cases like procurement, inventory, RFS, that is called quote management, work order, freight management, and return processing. In fact, in supply chain management, a lot of logistics company, they started, you know, deploying RPA bots to automate their lot of processes. IT, especially into IT help desk, whenever you find the opportunity of L1, L2 support, the incident management IT help desk, whenever a lot of tickets coming through email, definitely that is a very good use case where we can, you know, apply the RPA bots. Password reset, password lock, and all those things could be a very good use case. Reportings, a lot of reporting happens from compliance perspective, especially, you know, the ticket aging and the IT help desk, the process itself could be a very good use case. Consumer goods, it could be, either consumer goods or I would say e-commerce industry, P2P, O2C, O2C is your order to cash, R2P essentially report to record to report, inventory and good returns are very good use cases. And compliance industry, wherever you see compliance and reporting is happening on a very regular basis, that could be a very good use case. So last, this is the last slide from RPA perspective. Ladies and gentlemen, there are 120 tools in the industry available. 120 tools, even in fact, every day new tools are coming into the industry. Primarily, there are three tools that is very prominent and very, you know, has created a lot of value and impact into the industry. Blueprint, number one. Number two is Automation Anywhere. UI Path is the third one. But if you ask me from adoption perspective, which has got the larger share into the industry, that's where Automation Anywhere signs. It has got maximum adoption across the different industry, and it has got maximum revenue capitalization into the industry. It has got $100 million of overall, you know, the market capitalization. Second, market has been captured by the UiPath. It is the recent entry into industry. UiPath has got the second entry, and third one is Blueprint, but still into financial BFSI sector, Blueprint sign, because it has got, you know, reliability and scalability perspective that signs on the top. So this is about RPA. Now I'll go and brief about what is cognitive RPA, how RPA and artificial intelligence work together. But I have a few minutes to take up your questions.
Right, Madan. So what are the limitations of RPA?
Yes. All right. So this is slide. Of course, definitely this is cognitive RPA. Cognitive RPA is the integration of artificial intelligence and RPA together. So just skipping the initial slide. If you ask me what is the limitation, RPA only works on rule-based activity, rule-based processes. In your process, if any of the activity is rule-based, then only RPA will work, otherwise it will not work. So answer, the answer is very simple. It only work on structured data. So essentially mean, when you have everything has been defined, the data is there into spreadsheet or it's into database where rows and columns are being defined, that's where RPA will work. But the moment it will come to unstructured data, it will fail. This is one of the biggest limitation of RPA.
Hi, sir, one question. This is Sahil here.
Yes, Sahil. Yes, Sahil, go ahead. While we are waiting for your question. Sorry, Sahil, we are not able to hear you. Sorry, Sahil, we are not able to hear you. So I'll give you best example of unstructured data. Let's take example of email. So when any email comes in, when email lands in your mail, sorry, Sahil.
My question is,
Sahil, we are not able to hear you.
Hello.
So let's little talk about what is unstructured data. Anybody has any idea before I go and help you to understand?
Without any proper format.
Yeah, that's true. Without any proper format is called unstructured data. For example, the email. Let's understand what is the structure in email. If I'm getting any email from to, is the very much, you know, that I can definite, it's a definite field, it's a structure, I would say. But when it comes to body, in body, what is being written, essentially the bot cannot understand, it cannot infer any information. That is called unstructured data. Our invoices are unstructured data. Image is unstructured data. The scanned any document is unstructured data. So whenever you come across any unstructured data, RPA bot will fail, and this is the biggest limitation with you know, the RPA as a technology. So in any enterprise, 80% of the data is unstructured data. 20% of the time, the data is only structured. So if you see, essentially, whenever you want to automate any process, this is the 80-20% of the ratio. You cannot automate all the processes without having a marry with artificial intelligence with RPA. That's where RPA comes into handy with RPA. Artificial intelligence, and that's where it is called cognitive RPA. I got some question. I can hear some kids has also joined our meetup. That's nice, but can you please go on mute?
The mute button is at the bottom left corner of the screen, just in case somebody is not able to find that.
Can mute everyone. I don't want to mute because that will stop us to make this session interactive. Otherwise it would become, you know, very boring. We can do that, but I request everybody to go on mute, and whenever you want to stop me, please stop. So all right, so let's move ahead. So the limitation with RPA, that RPA only work on rule based activity where rules are pretty much defined, essentially mean the data is structured. That's where RPA will work. The moment data becomes unstructured, RPA will not able to take the judgment the way human do. In case your processes are very much complex, I'm going back to somebody asked me, what if my invoices types are very different and it's landing from a different vendor, then it becomes very complex. RPA alone cannot solve the issue. Here RPA and AI has to come together in order to, you know, scan all the invoices and identify what are the different format of the invoice, and then it will process. So let's little understand. So cognitive RPA, I mean, lot of you know, people are talking about cognitive RPA. Some vendors are talking about smart process automation. Some of the vendors are talking about intelligent process automation. Some industry is calling, Deloitte is calling it robotic cognitive automation. So let's understand what is cognitive RPA, or maybe robotic cognitive automation. So essentially it's nothing but when the RPA and artificial intelligence comes together and work together in order to automate the larger, you know, complex processes, that is called cognitive RPA. So RPA and AI is called cognitive RPA. Where RPA only automate the rule-based processes, structured data and simple processes, wherein our AI, machine learning and analytics actually, you know, automate a lot of complex processes, and that's where it becomes your cognitive RPA. Just a homework for you, for everybody, you know, RPA, AI and analytics, all three are working together. And that's where comes your process mining. That gives you the X-ray of your processes any point in time. Definitely RPA can automate your processes. AI can apply the intelligence on top of this. But when you want to get the operation insight, still you are not getting it. That's where analytics will come into picture. So it's a homework for you. Definitely we'll plan some different session, how RPA, AI and analytics will come together. But I mean, just a kind of, you know, tip for you to go and do a little bit of study. All right. So moving ahead. So what are the different components the RPA, cognitive RPA, you know, comes together? It has got NLP, natural language processing. We'll talk about it, how NLP and RPA will come together. In fact, it has got chatbot as well. It has got computer vision, that is called object vision or, you know, computer vision. It has got language translation. So essentially mean that in case the text is in Japanese language and you want to translate into, you know, English or maybe in another French or German, you can translate. Or maybe you want to detect what is the language, it can do it. Very interesting part is the OCR, optical character reader. This has got a very fantastic and interesting use case when it will be clubbed with RPA, and especially whenever, wherever you see the opportunity of paper-based transaction, OCR is doing a fantastic job along with RPA. Tone analyzer is something, it's coming along with RPA, you know, where you want to analyze the tone, what is the, you know, the tone or overall sentiment of the text, especially this is being used into your call center and the back office operation. Then data is discovery is something wherever you see the huge chunk of data where you can discover the data and find it out some, you can infer the decisions or infer the right information out of the data. So these are the components. It's not only limited to what is being documented. There are a lot of components may come together, but essentially this is almost all the platforms and, you know, the tools are in the process of evaluating what can be integrated together. So cognitive RPA, it has got almost everywhere. It has the use cases. It's not limited to what is being documented. It has got into HR. It has got into finance, BFSI, manufacturing, supply chain management, and healthcare. So if you ask me what is the contribution of RPA and AI, the cognitive part into HR or any processes, I would say 50% of the processes can be automated using RPA, 30% of the processes can be automated using the AI, and rest 20% cannot be automated at all, because this 20% required human intervention and human judgment in order to process the you know the transactions or the processes. The same case with finance, manufacturing, and BFSI. So RPA and you know AI that works together. RPA is the first step, and AI comes at the second stage in automating the most complex processes. So let's little understand. The first component is the natural language processing. What is natural language processing? So the great example would be, I would say, Siri. Siri is the great example of NLP. Siri, Alexa, or any chatbot that you see in any, you know, banking or any the application where the chatbots are, you know, pretty much capable enough to have the interaction, establish a very good conversation with the human. So that is the, you know, the best example. Chatbot is the best example of NLP. So fundamental question comes, what is NLP? So natural language processing is the ability of the computer to understand the text and process just like a human. This is called NLP. As of now, without NLP, computer don't have the capability to understand the text, what essentially the human are talking about, and it cannot process it. But now with the ability of NLP, it has capability to understand, and the best example is the chatbots. So let's little talk about NLP use cases. Customer help desk. So what happens when any email lands on the customer help desk, we cannot infer the sentiment or emotion of overall the text. We cannot essentially, the computer cannot understand what essentially this email is talking about. Really this email is talking about the customer frustrated, or customer is talking about good thing or bad thing. So a lot of use cases is coming along with NLP into customer help desk. Wherever a lot of emails are coming, the NLP is capable enough to process the text and understand what is the sentiment of the customer. This piece, customer feedback, it's not only customer feedback, but employee feedback as well. So wherever a lot of feedbacks are, you know, landing on the different social media, it could be landing on the internal website, and it's really huge. The one way would be, we can deploy a couple of people who would be all the time monitoring the feedback, or other way could be we can deploy, you can use NLP and it will, you know, monitor the feedback, and it will essentially give me what is the feedback about and what the people are talking about and what is the sentiment and emotion of overall employee about the company and about the brand. Third thing is the recruitment screening. I'm not sure if really you have seen a lot of recruitment company, they are deploying RPA and AI together in order to find the right relevant resume from 100 or thousands of resume. For example, if I have to screen, download thousands of resume or hundreds of resume from Naukri.com, really evaluate and find the relevant 10 resume from thousands of resume as per my job description, it's really a daunting task. This required a lot of human intervention and human judgment in order to do that. But a lot of products are coming on the way where they're applying NLP in order to find it out the right relevant resume using NLP, and definitely it's working. Shared services performance, I would say, what is happening? A lot of companies have their own internal websites where people are talking about rubbish, good thing or bad thing about the different departments. It's not easy to monitor all the content all the time. What people are talking about, this required all the time very attention from all the departments. So if you can really deploy a couple of bots to scrap the data and then apply NLP to find it out the sentiment, emotion of this overall content, definitely this will help the department to stay focused on their core work, and the bots can attract and, take the attention in finding out right stuff. Last but not the least, this branding stuff. What competitors are talking about my brand? What exactly the people are talking about my brand? It is spreaded across the multiple, social media channels. At the same time, it is into different feeds, emails, and different kinds of, the source of data. It's not easy in today's world where the social media has got a very diversified presence. So in case we get it married with NLP, definitely a lot of things will, that can be done using NLP. Any question on NLP? Anybody has any question before I move ahead? I know it's a little overwhelming, but I think it's a very good part where you can, go and do a lot of study by NLP, how especially customer service and, it's transforming into entire business using NLP.
So essentially, could you elaborate more on the technology stack that's being used for natural language processing, and are there any specific tools available? I know a lot of work over there is done in Python and leveraging other open source.
Yeah, sure. Just give me 1 minute. All right. So it's a very good, who has this question?
My name is Shabaz.
Shabaz. It's a very a good question, Shabaz, and very relevant question, because if I come from definitely from a coding background, or maybe if I'm coming from a business operation background, it's a very daunting task to write such kind of algorithm. It's not easy. So there are two different ways to handle this situation as a platform, or maybe I can write my own custom coding. And one of the platform that is a very prominent platform is the IBM Watson. It's one of the platform being, offered by IBM. The NLP, NLU, Chatbot, and what we talked about, computer vision, it is being all offered by IBM Watson out of the box. Being the business users, being the consumer of IBM Watson, it's just about consuming the API, passing the input, and then I'll get my output. That's all required into overall IBM Watson. Nothing more than that, nothing less than that. If I have to do the sentiment analysis, what customer are talking about my brand, I can give the input as unstructured data, overall text, it will process and it will give me the sentiment, whether customers are frustrated or pretty happy or maybe disgusting. So one platform is IBM Watson. Microsoft has got its own Microsoft Cognitive Services. Third one is the Amazon has got its clouds, Amazon Cognitive Services, and Google has got very, very good platform. So these are the prominent four platforms. I'm not sure in case there could be many more. There is another core.ai. So these are the platforms where you guys can use. It has got a lot of, in fact, training material, a lot of guidance, a lot of forums. And it's all ready made for you. You can go and consume it. Even business users can consume. But if you are a technology geek, for example, if you are a coder, you are a .NET, Java, or Python, you want to use, it has got a lot of libraries. Like NLTK is one of the very prominent library. You can use those library. So it all depends. There are a lot of banks who do not want to get on Watson or the Microsoft Cognitive Services due to, the compliance and regulatory issue. For them, the recommended approach would be they can use the open source, the tools using Python, .NET, Java, and they can build in-house. This doesn't require to get it into Amazon and Watson. But yes, that required different set of skill set. Hope this answers your question, Sabaj.
Yes, it does. Thank you so much.
Yeah, most welcome.
I have one question here.
Yeah.
So right now the thing here is, just we have some softwares as a that is Blue Prism, UiPath, and etc. for RPA only. And now for cognitive RPA, and for if I want to do any intelligence, then I have to use this IBM Watson, Google, and Amazon, etc. So these are the third-party content, so that we can make it together for this whole process.
Yes, you are absolutely right.
Okay, sure. Got it. Thanks.
Yep. So RPA as a tool, you either talk about UiPath or Blue Prism, they have plug and play. You can use any of the cognitive services, and that will cost you additional. It's not free. Whenever you use for commercial purpose, you have to pay the different, you know, money to IBM Watson.
Okay. So right now your question is, are we spying those third-party software directly, or are they just plug and play?
It's plug and play. I mean, if you are integrating Blue Prism with IBM Watson, it's not about spying, but consuming their web services and supplying the input, and you will get the output. Rest, all other control would be in your RPA tool.
Okay. So here the thing is, if I took anything from Siri or Alexa, then that text would, that voice would directly send to the IBM Watson, and they will take the action, whether it is a bad or happy, and they will reply us.
Yeah, that's true. So let's take example. Let's take one huge case. I think definitely this will help you to clear a lot of your doubts. So let's little talk about NLP or NLU use cases. So what is this talking about? One of the company, it's a very big enterprise. They run a survey very frequently. Once in a quarter, they run a survey and collect the response from 1,000 individuals. They ask the people to ask two open-ended questions, and all your respondent, you know, answered using 15 words each. So they used to collect some 2,000 to 5,000 open-ended response, that total of close to 30,000 words to 50,000 words. This is what happening into the survey. You can imagine the scale. Every fortnight, they are running this survey about their product, about their brand. So now the question comes, how can you review and identify the key insights from a response? The one way could be, definitely RPA will not work here. RPA don't have the capability to understand the insights or the inference of the information from the unstructured data from the survey. Definitely RPA will not work. So the only way is to integrate RPA with artificial intelligence, and then only you should be able to review and identify the key insights from the response. People are talking about good, bad, or they're talking about, let's assume if I'm hosting a survey about my AC, what they're talking about, AC is good, service is good, technician is good. So definitely NLP will be able to figure it out, all those insights quickly. Okay, so second use cases you can apply NLP, what are people saying about me? Essentially mean about my brand. So let's see some data. 90% of the customer read online review. 86% won't buy a product with fewer than 3 out of 5 stars. Customer voice their complaint on Twitter, Facebook, and other social media. So the fundamental question comes here, that being a brand, how can I review my brand information from the different social media? It's a daunting task. But if I apply NLP, it will become very easy to figure it out what people are talking about my brand. In similar case, if I have to review the brand about the competitors, what people are talking about my competitors, for example, if I am there into Pune, if I'm running a very good restaurant, that is fine. People are talking about good about my restaurant. But if I have to figure out what people are talking about my competitors, definitely I can, power my RPA bot with NLP, and NLP is capable enough to figure it out what people are talking about. Okay. So there are a couple of huge cases. I mean, this part I'll transfer to some other day because one of the gentlemen could not join my session due to personal emergency. But I'll show you one OCR piece, how OCR works.
Madan, in the meantime, if we have to, you know, if you have any technical challenges and we have to reach out to you.
Can you repeat your question once again?
Yeah, this is Ravindra. If you have any technical challenges and we want to seek your help, how can we reach out to you?
Yeah, I never mind. You can reach out to me. I mean, with my limited capacity, I should be able to help you.
Yeah, but your email ID?
I think it's already there. I send you in my email. I'll send it everybody to thank you email, which is my email ID. But let's quickly, you know, understand what is OCR. OCR is optical character reader, and that actually helps to scrap, you know, a lot of invoices. It transforms unstructured data to structured data. When OCR works together with RPA, that transform a lot of invoice from unstructured to structure, and that creates a touch-free, you know, the process invoice processing pipeline. Let's see what is happening. Sorry, I was on mute. So the message is very clear here. OCR is being powered by artificial intelligence, and it has pretty much capability to transform any invoice, unstructured invoice, to structured, and then from where RPA will pick it up and enter into any system. So in case you come across invoices in account payable, you are getting hundreds and thousands of invoices every month. Any OCR tools are capable enough to transform your entire invoices without touching anything. It's all about training your invoices, configuring, and in case any mistakes, automatic OCR will learn automatically, and it will transform your entire OCR into, you know, SAP or the different format, you know, the electronic document. So it's very powerful. OCR, apart from OCR, there are a lot of other tools. For example, Nuance has also got a very good platform, and there are a couple of others, but OCR, Abby and Nuance has got very good. In case you want to evaluate free of cost, Tesseract is free, absolutely free. It's being offered by Google, but it's not so powerful as used to be Abby and, you know, the Nuance one. So it's a very good stuff. Probably you can take a look how OCR work together. All right, so so for today, this is what from my side. There would be another session post next to next week where we would be showing you how the RPA Blue Prism can work with IBM Watson to analyze, you know, the NLP, NLU, as well as computer vision, as well as chatbot. So we'll show you, it will be a kind of a small 45 minute of boot camp where we'll demonstrate how RPA, chatbot, OCR as well as IBM Watson will come together. So we are open for question. In case you have any questions, most welcome. Somebody pinged me here that can we create a WhatsApp group? It's a great initiative, but the fundamental question comes, how I'll get your mail ID? I'm just texting my mail ID here on the chat window. In case you send me your mail ID, I should be more than happy to create, a group for everybody benefit.
Madan, one question here. So I would like to ask if are there any online test use cases that we can try on our own just to check it out, how the RPA can be combined with the cognitive tools like you mentioned others. So are there any use cases or any website where we can find some other use cases so we can try it on our own for a while?
Yes, there are a lot of use cases. I mean, in fact, what I showed you, this is primarily into customer care, BPO and front office operation. But there could be many more in case you want. So guys, don't post on, this chat window. It would be very difficult for me to take it from here. In case you can send me on my mail ID, I can consolidate. So I do not need only your mail ID, but your phone number as well. This would be great because I can put it on the WhatsApp. It will be very instant access. Thanks, Rajiv, for attending and hearing me.
Otherwise, if you can make any WhatsApp group or such sessions, wherever you can post some.
Yeah. So I can do that. I mean, this required a lot of efforts and energy to, mobilize the people. But in case you send me your mail ID and phone number, on my sorry guys, don't post it here, it will be very difficult. In case you send me on my mail ID, I can put my efforts and energy with the WhatsApp for everybody benefit. Keep conducting a lot of webinars, we can probably send you invitation. Please send me your details on my mail ID, and I'm, or maybe this is my number,
914641, is that the one?
Yeah, 914640187. In case you can ping me on, Sindhu, please send me the email. Otherwise, it will be very difficult for me to, find it out all the chat and scan across. Please send across on my mail. I should be able to one day sit and consolidate and create a WhatsApp group. Thanks, Prabhu. It's my pleasure. I'll send you guys a couple of cognitive RPA use cases, though I tried to explain here in my slide, but I'm not sure how many of you got it. This is very prominent use cases that happen across, a lot of industry. A lot of, companies are doing this.
Hi, Madan, Sahil here. I have one question.
Yes, Sahil.
Yeah, many organizations are preferring the .NET professionals, .NET background for RPA professional. So is it worth to try out an RPA if someone is from non-.NET background and already having more than 10 years of experience?
I'll tell you why the companies are preferring to have the .NET background, because all the RPA tools are being it's built up on top of .NET. And almost all the tools are, giving support to the .NET, either VB.NET or C#. But it has got a different spectrum as well. In case you are from Python, or if you know VB scripting or Java scripting, even though you can write the code into Python and call the Python in RPA tools. So it's not very much limited to .NET. In fact, if you come from a Python or JavaScript background, you can write and you can call it here. Number one. Number two, being the 10 years of experience guy, it's not limiting you to, just bogged down by .NET or RPA. Probably you can think, how can you hone your project management skill into RPA?
Okay.
Yeah. So don't get only bogged down and being, try to hone your project management skill. How can you become the leader? How can you become the driver? where you can lead the entire automation project. You can sit on top of 5 RPA developers and you can, you know, do the entire transformation. And don't try to limit yourself only till RPA. Now RPA, AI and analytics all are coming together. I'm trying to arrange one session with one of the experts who would be talking about how RPA and analytics will work together. So my sincere request to everybody, don't see RPA only as opportunity. RPA along with AI and analytics creating humongous opportunity, and by 2025, it will be close to $215 billion of market. It's got huge opportunity.
Well, then I have one question. This is Pankaj again. Sorry. It's just about the series of process. Now APV starts with a scanning to index to post to pay to statement rec and the accrual booking. So any of the sub process or a step has a pain area we can implement RPA, or it is end to end process?
If you can give me 30 seconds, I'll pull it out your P2P process and I'll show you how things happens.
Okay.
With everybody. Okay. Just bear with me for 2 minutes, guys. So though this is part of my strategic management training, I had conducted a lot of trainings in strategic management, but I'll just demonstrate you how things happens. Pankaj, this is for you. I think you understand better than anybody. This is procure to pay.
Thanks so much, sir.
So you see here, typically procure to pay is this cycle, this process exists into any company. You go across finance, supply chain management, you go to, you know, supply chain, everywhere procure to pay exists. And essentially basic objective, you, if you want to buy some goods, you can buy and pay the money. This is what procure to pay. So let's little talk about request for quotation. So what happens normally in request for quotation? Agent will submit a quote across email. Underwriter will receive the quotation. Somebody will review, create the entry into SAP, right? So it looks very nice when I have single quotation, but what if I have 500 vendors and all the vendors are sending the quotation using the email? One or two person all the time, they would be, you know, creating the data into SAP. So this process, if somebody is sending the quotation to you in email attachment or Excel file, it's pretty much you can deploy RPA bots to download the Excel and create the entry to SAP. There won't be any touch from the human side. You see here this process. All the greens are being automated using RPA bots. Earlier, this is being handled by human. I don't know how many, what is the scale of human, but this process is being automated by bot. It will create the code.
But Madan, only one point is here is it requires a decision making, you know, strategic decision making, the best price, the quantity and the terms of delivery and the conditions. So will the bot be able to take those decisions, which is the best one to pick?
So Pankaj, let's go one by one. Let's assume you have total 10 activity into this this request for quotation, right?
Okay.
Out of 10 activity as of now, you think that there are 3 activity that is really painful. Being the strategic guy, if I am the whole day, I'm making the decisions, there are 3 activity that is really brutal, and that is the data entry. To go ahead with RPA, at least I can automate 3 activities. Rest 7, I'll take care later. Pankaj.
I hear you.
Yeah. So what I said, out of 10 activities, let's assume there are 3 activities that is pretty low hanging fruit. That is the data entry, very brutal. At least 3 activity can be automated to start with. If this will free your 20% of your bandwidth, I think you should be able to justify and then move ahead integrating AI or maybe integrating cognitive.
Okay, but I understand.
Approaching all the process 100%, but it's about approaching one by one. It's a journey, it's not a destination.
Okay.
So let's so good receipt has not got very prominent, but let's little understand for the conscious of time, the account payable process. So let's see here what is happening. Your invoice is landing via email and then this is being scanned by this. This is being received by the human and humans are, you know, pulling the purchase order and matching the purchase order with invoice. In case purchase order or supplier name is not matching, it's raising the business exceptions and it's again going back to the supplier. In case supplier name is matching, it's matching, tallying the invoice number, and that is called two-way and three-way process matching. If everything is matching perfectly fine, then your invoice is ready for the payment. This will get it into some different queue. So you see this process, what is happening. Let's assume you have got 100 of invoices daily, that there are 2-3 people or there are a bunch of people who are, you know, all the time scanning the invoices, pulling the purchase order, matching the data, getting into SAP, calculating, and then raising the exception or maybe making the invoice ready for the. So this is all brutal process. But when I automate it, almost 60% or 70% of the process is the activity inside the account payable is being automated. But this has not happened in one go. It's all a journey. This took, it took minimum, you know, 3 months to 6 months of time to automate the entire account payable, the entire, you know, invoice processing. So first we need to identify the first step. What is my pain point? Could be data entry, could be invoice processing, could be validation. I can automate one thing and then take the learning and move ahead. So Pankaj, coming back to your question, invoice processing and payment processing is the area almost all the companies are evaluating or adopting or doing some level of automation.
Yeah. So only one thing I'm curious to know, probably in the interest of the group also, whether it's any of the processes or the business segment, probably in the next session or when we enroll that, probably we pick up one case and then we go through how the logic to be built and how it operates.
Yeah, definitely. We can do that.
This was an overview and a briefing session on pros and cons of the tool, right?
Yeah. So next time, let's do one thing. Next time we can pick it up one small process. We can pull it out tool and how can we marry the tool with the process? We can do that.
Great.
That will give everybody a very fair bit of idea. So maybe after Diwali, we can do that.
Sure, sir. Sounds good. Thank you.
All right. Anybody has got any question?
No, Madan. Thank you so much. Thanks for your time.
All right, guys. Thank you. So in case you
recording.
Yeah, definitely. I'll share in case you want to have the WhatsApp group, please send me your email. Send me email with your mail ID and phone number. I'll create a WhatsApp group. And we would be instantly available for any conversation and collaboration.
Great, sir.
All right. Thank you, guys.
Thank you.
Thanks, everyone. Great day ahead. Bye-bye.
Yep, bye-bye.
Thanks, Madan.
Yep, thanks, guys.
Thank you, Madan. Thank you so much.
Yeah, thanks, guys.
Thank you.
Thank you. Bye-bye.
Thank you, Madan.
Hello, Madan, sir.
Yeah, I'm there.
Yeah, Ismail here. Ismail.
Hey, Ismail.
Yeah, hi sir. I had pinned you a question in personal.
Yeah.
So yeah, I was asking about some links or the videos available if you could share.
For cognitive.
Yeah, cognitive. The SAP automation which you showed a few minutes ago.
Yeah, I'll share with you.
The similar links, if you could share, will be great for our reference.
Yeah. Please send me your mail ID and phone number. I'll send it to everybody.
I have sent you the mail ID and phone number in personal.
Sure. So guys, one more request. I keep conducting such kind of webinars in case somebody would be interested to help me organizing such kind of events, joining the hands together, most welcome. Please ping me on my WhatsApp. We can organize such kind of more and more events for the community. In case anybody can help me with respect to organizing such kind of events.
Sure, Madan. Would give a shot.
Yep. Thanks, guys.
Bye-bye. Thanks, everyone. Good day ahead. Bye-bye.
ये जो नंबर डाले हैं उनका नंबर